this is me and my dad. It's probably circa 1988. And I'm starting with this slide. I've never showed this slide before. I'm starting with it because we are on a camping trip, and camping is something that is just really important to me, and it has influenced my work a lot. So we'll be talking about it a lot. I went on my first camping trip when I was 3 months old, and we went camping about 3 times a year for every year of my life and since then. So I still feel really comfortable in plaid and really comfortable in the woods. And then another reason I'm showing this slide is because I lost my father when I was about, I just turned 15. And so in addition to camping, this slide represents some of my anxieties that feed into my work, namely anxieties about time. And so when that happened, it's probably genetic anyway, but when that happened, it really like opened up this anxiety that I have about not fully embracing my present and just sort of letting it slide by. So I'm going to start with these series of paintings which I made some time ago now. But with that in mind, so as a little kid, I'll just tell you this little story. I remember going to the grocery store, and like, you know how the aisles are like super shiny and you can see the reflection of the lights in the floor. And I hated going to the grocery store, I thought it was really boring, and so I used to try to jump on the lights, like the reflection of the lights in the aisles. But every time you move to try to jump on the lights would move. So you can never actually land on the lights. And that is the way that I feel about time and the presence, is that just when you think you're trying, just as you think you got it, it like slips away, because then that moment that you were trying to get is now gone, and the moment that you think you got it, you're like in a new moment now, and then you try. So it's just, and that just gives me a lot of anxiety. It feels like really competitive, which I don't like competition, or I like competition, but like and so that chase was something that I really wanted to try to capture, but I also was sort of making fun of it because it doesn't work. And so for me to like try really hard to make work that talks about that, it's sort of setting myself up for failure. But the process itself was actually really helpful in at least allowing myself to be present. So even if it didn't successfully capture the present, I was able to, I'll explain the process a little bit. So I stretched a canvas, picked a couple colors, and found a spot. And I chose the spot just based on whatever shadows were projected onto the surface of the canvas. And I would just try to like madly trace those shadows with my paint. And so as I could only paint for about 10 minutes at a time, and I'd go out at the same time every day. So I have a couple canvases going at the same time, and just go try to scramble it and get the shadows down. But even over the course of 10 minutes, the shadows moved quite a bit. And then the wind would also blow. And so there was just this movement that I would capture. And I'd go out, I'd have a couple sessions and just to sort of decide when the painting was done. But in that process, I was able to just be. And so regardless of whether the painting allowed the viewer to just be, the painting was a representation of the moment when I could. And so that was somewhat of a success for me. But I also felt like I wasn't doing anything. I felt like I was just the medium through which nature was making a painting or nature was making a drawing. And so I did drawings as well. And I loved the way, like exactly the same process, just a different location. And it just reveals some things about the location that you can't see with your own eyes. So through this process, you start to trace a little bit of the direction of the sun or the way that the wind tends to blow or the vibration of the trees, like so how stiff or fluid the trees were blowing or the speed at which they were blowing. Little nuances about the land or the area that I chose that I otherwise would not have been able to sense. So eventually I got a little bit tired of not having any say and really just tracing what I saw, and I would bring the paintings back to the studio and work on them and then bring them back outside and then bring them back a studio to work on them, adding myself in as a decision maker. And so I felt like this was a more even collaboration between me and my site. I still felt like I was sort of receiving, but I was also responding, and that was more satisfying. But the paintings weren't very practical. I still have my winter gear, but if it was cloudy and there were no shadows, if it was rainy, there were just too many factors that would prohibit me from going outside and painting. And on days that could have been really great studio days where I had my schedule clear, if it was cloudy, I couldn't paint. So it just didn't make a lot of sense. So I tried to make them in my studio, just using nature as my resource. And I had full control. The trick there is trying to, you know, be in the present, because I'm no longer in that process, and so now I'm totally in my head, and I'm trying to make a painting that looks fresh, that looks like I'm in the present, but I'm kind of faking it, sort of making it up. And so I try to make the paint my muse and use the paint to show the action, but it was like the paint was doing both things. It was no longer, I didn't have the third thing anymore, and so it just got kind of tricky, and the time element started to sort of go away. So while these paintings were fun, they just weren't as satisfying to me as far as that sort of presence. So I started doing some searching, and I'm a list maker, and I'm always sort of frustrated by my need to be kind of logical and mathematical, and I write everything down and I organize everything, and it gets annoying to myself. But I started saving my list because I noticed aesthetically they were sort of interesting, and I also really liked conceptually the way that when you make a list, you're writing down something for the future to do in the future, and then you cross things off once they're done, so that's the past. But there's this hole for the present. The list is the present. So whatever state the list is in that moment is your present moment. And I liked that. And I started thinking of paintings as lists of marks. So hold on to that. In the meantime, I was also working in theater. And so this is a children's show, Peter Pan. And I was doing scenic design. So I designed this piece. I also painted it and helped construct it. And so working with a narrative was something that I always really actually hated doing in art making. But in theater, the narrative, you're given the narrative, and then you have to design a set to then go with the narrative. So that was something new for me. And also with theater is that presence. It wasn't necessarily my present when I was making the piece or designing the piece. That's all, you do that ahead of schedule. But then the actual theater moment is very much in the present. So there's something about theater that I've always been attracted to, that performative aspect. So I did theater all through college, and then after college was how I made my money, was doing scenic painting and scenic design. This is another design for West Side Story that was cabaret. Okay, so along with those lists, so I was thinking about lists, I was thinking about marks as lists. I also was thinking, so marks as lists, okay, so making paintings using marks and making a list of marks still didn't solve my need for having a reason for the mark making. So when I was outside making those paintings and the shadows were telling me where to make the marks, I was still struggling in the studio trying to be quote unquote authentic with my mark making and having an experience where I could just be. So my family, so when my brother went to college, because of my father's passing, my mother was very sort of obsessed about all of our well-beings, which most mothers are anyway, but if she didn't hear from my brother every night, she would just assume the worst. And so my brother, being the very good boy that he is, would email my mother every night. So when I went to college, I was like, well, damn, I have to email my mom every night? I'm not necessarily home. And so anyway, so our life, thinking about them as scripts in a theater sense, but then also thinking about them as narratives and ways to sort of give me that action that I was looking for. So I started making paintings based on those emails that told a story. And so the marks were still lists, but the marks were responding to actions that I or one of my family members had written about. And so I had a purpose for the marks, which was helping me feel more authentic. But what ended up happening was that the piece felt like an archive of something. So it felt like it was almost like evidence of a performance had. And so the piece itself wasn't satisfying, whereas the process was more satisfying for me, the end result was less satisfying. Still sort of struggling. So then I made this piece, and accidentally, I mean, when I was spray painting it, I just spray painted onto the wall. And that was when it sort of clicked. And I'm skipping a little bit, like I was making a bunch of different paintings and finally realized that maybe what I needed to do in order to make the surface of the painting feel as present as I felt when I was making it was to get rid of the surface and not use the support at all. Because in theater, you are in the experience when you are in the scenery. And so why would I use a two-dimensional picture plane to ask the viewer to enter it and to pretend that they're within it? Or, you know, why not just create the space for the viewer to be in? So I started making pieces in space. So these are very subtle pieces that I made on a wall. Again, lists as marks as lists, recording different speeds and different actions, but the viewer could stand in front of it and be with it in the same time space. And so that was a bit more satisfying. So they got bigger. I started making them a little bit less subtle. Not referring to a present, but creating a present. So this was my first like large scale installation, thinking about the space as a painting and thinking about how I could make a few gestures in one space that would then activate the space itself and sort of loop the space into the piece and make a very large piece only with a few gestures, if that makes sense. So this piece is a pedestal closet in a gallery. And so when you walk in to your right, you see some movable walls, and behind the walls are all of the pedestals stacked on top of each other. And there's some, you can kind of peek in and see them. And then on the left side is this black kind of bookshelf thing with a whole bunch of white objects that are staring at the larger pedestals that are kind of peeking, like Mr. Wilson, like over the movable wall. Two different sources of light, so there's a fluorescent light on the left side and then a spotlight, like a Fresnel theater spotlight on the right. So the lighting was talking to each other as well. And so this was sort of my biggest, at that moment, opportunity to create a scenery, but it wasn't responding to a narrative. It was responding to my own feeling in that space. There's a term called Einfühlung, which literally translates to empathy. But what it means is, I'm just going to read it: a special participation in the life of things, the opposite of inspection. And the example is: to inspect a panther means to regard it as a window on the humanity around it. To feel one's way into the nature of the animal means that one is no longer outside, but has let oneself into the very center, the place from where it begins to be a panther.